discussed in this chapter. So yeah, what does Gryffindor, what a problem has he created? There's been a theft. Where has the theft been? At the clergyman's house. And yes, when Mrs. Hall went to Griffin's room, was he there? No, he was not there. First, he was not there, right? And what did the furniture start like behaving? Furniture behaved? No, he was not there in the room. And later on, you know, like, of course, yeah, it was when maybe they had gone out or they were down and then he came back. And then they, like, when she went to check and then he picked up the chair and everything like that, isn't it? Initially, he was not there, but at that moment only he must have come. And yes, now, what is Mrs. Hall blaming Griffin for? For doing some magic to her furniture? Then later on, when they come to know about the robbery, yes, about the theft that has taken place. And what is very strange that the clergyman noticed? What was the strange thing that the clergyman noticed? Yes, they could hear the sound of the coins, and but they could not see any person. So that was very, very strange, right? So they had come armed with a poker to catch hold of the thief, but they could not find anyone, right? So now Mrs. Hall is quite sure, everybody is quite sure, who is the thief? Griffin. And they have called the constable, right? The constable has come to arrest. And yes, what does Griffin show them? What does Griffin show the people, the villagers? What did he start doing? He started removing his bandages from his face. And they could see that only the headless person they could see. So everybody is quite scared, and the constable has come to arrest a person, and he has to do his duty. He has to arrest a person whether he has a head or not, whether he is visible or whether invisible. Okay? Yes, so can we finish with this chapter? We're doing the last page of the story. Open to page 30. Yes? No, we're doing 30 only. So let's start. Suddenly, let's start from this paragraph. Suddenly, he threw bandages, whiskers, spectacles, and even nose. It took him only a minute to do this. The horrified people in the bar found themselves staring at a headless man. So they're very surprised. What do they see? A headless person, because Griffin has removed his bandages. Mr. Jeffers, the constable, now arrived and was quite surprised to find that he had to arrest a man without a head. But Jeffers was not easily prevented from doing his duty. If a magistrate's warrant ordered a person's arrest, then that person had to be arrested with or without his head. So Jaffer was a very dutiful person. And Ardik, stop drawing on your book and read it, please. Right? So Mr. Jaffers, he's come to arrest the person. He's very surprised to see that the person is headless, but he is going to do his duty. Now, what does the scientist do further? They followed a remarkable scene as the policeman tried to get hold of a man who was becoming more and more invisible as he threw off one garment after another. So he's scaring the people. He's showing them that I am invisible. And of course, he's removed his bandages and now he's removing one garment after the other. He's taking off his coat and shirt, right? Finally, a shirt flew into the air and the constable found himself struggling with someone he could not see at all. So here, Griffin is making things very difficult for the constable, saying, you've come to arrest me. Let's see how you can arrest an invisible man, right? Some people tried to help him, but found themselves hit by blows that seemed to come from nowhere. So like, imagine, how are you going to catch an invisible person? Some people, they tried to catch hold of him. They did the best, running here and there or jumping here, falling on that person. But they were hit by that person. Blows to be hit. Okay? In the end, Jaffers was knocked unconscious because Griffin could see those people, but they could not see him. So he had an advantage. He was kicking them and he was, you know, scaring them and telling that you cannot catch hold of me. I'm invisible. In the end, Jaffers was knocked down unconscious as he made a last attempt to hold to the unseen scientist. They were nervous, excited cries of "Hold him!" But this was easier said than done. Griffin had shaken himself free and no one knew where to lay hands on him. So the man has run away, right? And everybody is screaming, hold him, but they can't hold him because they can't see him. And so once again, the man has disappeared. So of course, do you think he's going to commit more crimes now? So from here also, he's run away. He's now, how is he going to find shelter? Where is he going to live? What is he going to do? If you want to find out what happens to the invisible man, you will have to read the book to find out that. Do you want to know? You say, no, ma'am, we don't want to know. We can't read the book. Isn't it? Yes. Okay. So let's come to the questions here. Griffin was rather a lawless person. Comment. How was Griffin a lawless person? Because he broke laws? Yes, he did not, right? We'll come to that later, but how is he lawless? Someone who does not obey the laws, someone who does not follow the laws, yes. Okay, do only two questions, then you people are going to be very happy, isn't it? Okay. So Griffin was lawless because he had broken the laws. Not only here, but before coming to this place, when he was in London also, that time also he broke the laws. Yes or no? Yes. So he did create a lot of problems over there, and you can discuss all the things that he had done. How he burnt his house down, how he slept in that shop, and so he was there. Naturally, you're taking something without paying for it. It is a crime. So he ate food over there. He slept also. He picked up clothes to wear. But the next morning when the assistants arrived, he had to run away from there. And once again, he had to remove all the clothes and he went away. Then he went to the costume shop. There again, he stole things. He stole money. He injured the owner. He ran away from there. He's come to this village, Iping, right? Here living on stolen money. And then once again, he commits a crime. And when the people have found out that he is there, a criminal, and he's stolen money, what does he do? He runs away from there, right? This is as a lawless person, as a person who breaks laws. What do we think about Griffin as a scientist? What do we think about him as a scientist? So he discovered the formula for invisibility. That means he's very hardworking. He's quite intelligent, right? Yes. And he has all the qualities of a scientist. But what is there lacking in him, which many scientists do have? Yes? Positivity. Okay. It is about his responsibility, because when you are a scientist and you have discovered something very, very important, how are you going to use it? Therein lies the responsibility. Was he a responsible person? No, he was not. And what do you think about it? Was he, you know, like when you talk about scientists, when they have discovered things, when they're working for the benefit of society, do they want credit, recognition, right? Or, of course, we're talking about You can say working for the benefit of society, right? So all of these here, when we talk about Griffin, he could have got recognition as a great scientist. He could have got credit for this formula, but because he did not want to use it in a nice way, he did not want to use it in a beneficial way. So that is why he did not get the respect. And if you read this book, you will find out that in the end, he dies like a criminal. Chased, you know, like, and most wanted, you know, that kind, right? Everybody is there chasing him and scared of him. Jenny, this is not how we should feel around scientists, right? So as a scientist, he was not, you know, like, of course, living up to the expectations of society. He was very selfish, thought about himself only. He wanted to be very powerful, did not think about the benefit of society, right? And of course, he wanted to use his powers to show his strength, to show his supremacy over others, rather than being a nice contributing member of society. Okay, right. Now let's see, would you like to become invisible? Yes? No? If you want to become, what are the advantages of becoming invisible? What are the advantages of becoming invisible? You can go wherever you want to. Yeah? Like, yes, you can go wherever you are prohibited. You can go anywhere, everywhere. What? Free of cost. Very nice. You can go free of cost. You don't have to buy tickets for a movie or a ticket for a ride. You can go to any hill station you want to, right? You don't have to carry your report. Pura world get pedal. Okay, you go on an aeroplane, catch a flight, go there. What are the disadvantages? When you are invisible, how can people see you? That is advantages of being invisible. You don't want to be seen. What are the disadvantages? You can't get its credit. Also, you have to become visible to show. You will be feeling cold, you will be feeling hungry also. Would you end up feeling lonely also? Yes. Yes. Right? You people can't live without your friends. You need them. Okay, you sit in the middle of the friends and listen to what they have to talk. Very nice. Very interesting. And you talk in the air also. You scared them. This is what you would love to do if you became invisible. Okay. So your friends should always wish that you don't become invisible. Right? So you want to do all that. Disadvantages, yes, you'll be lonely. And of course, people might try to, if they come aware of it, they might try to hurt you and harm you to get that formula. Right? So of course, once again, it is there. It is going to be quite a difficult life. Are there forces around us that are invisible? Yes, we can't live our social life. You can't go on an aeroplane without a ticket. As they said, you can go anywhere, right? You can travel wherever you want to. And yes. So are there forces around us that are invisible? For example, magnetism. Gravity is invisible. Yeah. Now, are there aspects of matter that are invisible or not visible to the naked eye? Of course, yes. So when you come to the smallest particles, they are invisible. You talk about your atoms and all, isn't it? Right? So they are invisible. But when they all get together and so many of them coming together, then they make things. What? Visible? Yes. Now, what would the world be like if you could see such forces or such aspects of matter? If you could see that force of magnetism? If you could see that gravity, how would it make it? Would that mystery about life be lost? You could see the wind, right? Then, there are some secrets which nature has kept from us. And maybe, yeah, there are things which we are now aware of them. We have found out that it exists, but we have not found it a way to see it. We can actually feel it and measure it and assess it, but we cannot make it visible. So some things about nature, it is better if they are left like that. Do you think interfering with nature, it is going to cause problems also? Isn't it? Right? If you could see magnetism, what do you think? How would it be like? Rays coming, lines coming, what? Yes? Sparks coming out? What about electricity? We use it so much. How is it visible? Is it visible? We can't even think about it. You see all those electrons or whatever roaming around here and there if you had to, if you could see it, isn't it? And then you'll think, oh my God, science and physics at home also. Isn't it? We don't want to see it. So yes, so there are some you'll be able to see it. Okay, there goes electricity. There goes magnetism. Right? There is gravity there, right? And you can see it right now. You keep on throwing things down. They see gravity. Okay, then you can see your gravity force, isn't it? But after some time, you lose that curiosity also, because if it was a part of our life, we would not pay much attention to it. Yeah. Yeah, so you can do that also, right? Yes, so there are things here which we need not tamper with. That is why certain things are there, not visible and not visible. Okay, fine. You're going to study. Okay, science will become difficult. 10th May? Invisibility. No, you will have to find it out on your own. There is not telling. And you know, when he did write down that invisibility formula, he made it in some kind of a code language so that nobody could even understand what he has written. Encrypted data. Okay, very good. Very nice. Okay. Now, what makes glass or water transparent? What is the scientific explanation for this? So much of science we're doing today. Do you think it would be scientifically possible for a man to become invisible or transparent? Yeah. So if we are able to make, light can pass through us, right? So we don't have that opacity, which we have, then maybe we would be able to find a way. So lots of work and lots of calculations need to be done. Okay, right. So with this, we come and end right to the chapter, Invisible Man. And right, what are the other chapters that we have to do from this book? Yes, so we have the first chapter is The Triumph of Surgery, second is A Thief's Story, and we have this one, Footprints Without Feet. So three chapters from this book would be included in the first term, along with other skills and other things that have already been discussed with you. Is it clear? Is it okay? Fine. This is your regular period, at least note down your English period. This is going to be a regular one every week. Yeah, tomorrow we have a regular period as it is. Okay, fine. Right. So any doubts, any questions, anyone from this chapter? Would you like to become a scientist? Anyone would like to become a scientist over here? Okay. What is he interested in? Why are you shouting so much? I need to mute you all. I think so. So yeah, why do you want to become a scientist? Or what course, as we have discussed here, requires a lot of hard work, a lot of dedication to become a scientist? Of course. We'll see to it, don't worry. We will manage. We'll manage. Don't worry. Right. Okay.